Good afternoon and welcome to today's webinar on mushrooms for healthy diets, what's new? The webinar is being presented by Dr. Flavia Fayet-Moore. Dr. Flavia Fayet-Moore is certainly very well qualified to talk about the health benefits of mushrooms with no less than 3 degrees. So Flavia is a registered nutritionist and a practicing dietitian, a board certified lifestyle medicine professional, and an Honorary Associate of the University of Sydney. Wow, that is really something. So Flavia has graduated originally from the University of Toronto in a Bachelor of Nutritional Sciences, but then went on to get a Master of Nutrition and Dietetics and a PhD in Nutrition from the University of Sydney, which is, wow, that is one hell of a lot of qualifications and letters after your name. Very impressive. So since completing her PhD, Flavia has focused her research and advocacy work on nutritional epidemiology, micronutrients, and bioactives. And she's used her findings to promote a food-first approach to address public health's biggest problems, including vitamin D deficiency, which I know Flavia is going to talk quite a lot about today. And it's so interesting. You wait till you hear about this, as well as anaemia and chronic disease. So Flavia is passionate about improving the health of Australians, especially children and adolescents, through research and its translation. She is a member of the Nutrition Society of Australia and the Dietitians Association of Australia, and as fellow of the Australasian Society of Lifestyle Medicine. This presentation is based on the Hort Innovation Project, educating health professionals about Australian mushrooms. So please type in your questions during the webinar. Don't just wait till the end. And note that the webinar is being recorded and we will send a link to everyone who registered. So please feel free to share with anyone you think would be interested in this material, which I think should be the entire population of Australia. So this webinar is brought to you thanks to the Marsh Lawson Mushroom Research Centre Project and of course Flavia's Health Professionals Project MU17002, both of which are supported through the Mushroom Levy with matching funds from the Australian government. Now, Flavia has got a little bit of a sore throat, so she's feeling a little bit husky, which in the sort of Neville Wren style, but I'm sure we can still hear her and what she has to say will be of great interest, I'm sure. And over to you, Flavia.
Great, thank you so much. And I'm devastated that I lost my voice. But hopefully the message will not be lost for today, because I'm just so excited to be able to share research on one of my all-time most favorite foods that I'll have to disclose, which is mushrooms. I love it, my whole family loves it, and it's just so cool that we get to research it. So the whole point of today is to be able to share all those amazing insights and findings from our research with you growers that are so intimately involved with the production of this amazing food. So to start off with, I just want to highlight what I'm going to be covering today. I tried to incorporate as much as I could by making sure that it's still very relevant. So by the end of the presentation, you'll have an overview of the science of mushrooms, what's new, where is it at, and then I'm going to talk about a little bit about vitamin D. I know you all know that mushrooms can produce vitamin D, but there might be some really interesting things that you might not have known. And then I'm gonna talk about the practical tips, because nutrition is only relevant if people are eating the food. So what are some practical mushroom tips that can help people make food tastier? And then talk about, well, what's next for mushrooms? Where do we go from here? So there's a long history of evidence of science researching mushrooms. Now, the first antibiotic, which I may or may not need today, is penicillin, was actually derived from fungi. There's also a lot of medicinal mushrooms being used for treatments of mental health. But when it comes to health effects, there's loads of research. But the problem is that the evidence is not in humans. It's in cell lines, it's in animal studies. So we wanted to find out, what is the evidence in humans? Because it's a human evidence that we can utilize to communicate the health benefits of mushrooms. The other evidence is all great to get to the human, but we need more research, actually investigating the effect of mushroom on health. So what does the science behind mushrooms look like? As part of our project and the systematic literature review that we did, we looked at all the science to see what had people done before. And there were over 300 reviews on the science of mushrooms. So there's a huge interest in the space. But the problem is that only a few were systematic, which is the gold standard to review the science, and none were one on the most popular mushroom, Agaricus bisporus. So we set out to the first determine, well, what is the evidence on Agaricus bisporus? What are the bioactives in those mushrooms? And in turn, what is the health effect of those mushrooms in humans? We published the study, and you can access it quite easily. It's all open access. And in our research, the two key things we found, that there were 15 human studies, so it's not a huge amount, but it's significant. And there were 53 bioactive studies showcasing what's actually in mushrooms. So what did we find? It's really, really easy to remember. You just think about A, B, C, D, E. And those are your bioactives. So A for antioxidants, and most of the reported antioxidants are polyphenols. Beta glucans, which is really interesting because a lot of the research on beta glucans is how they help modulate the immune system. And 10% of mushrooms, so dry weight, is made up of beta glucans. So there's huge opportunity to also investigate how the mushroom beta glucans specifically is involved with heart health. There's also chitin, there's vitamin D, there's actually vitamin D in mushrooms without even exposing it to the sun, although in small amounts. Then there's ergosterol and ergothionine. So I want to focus on those three, which are the most interesting in my next slide. So the first one is ergosterol. So just like cholesterol in our skin, fungi and Agaricus bisporus mushrooms have ergosterol. And when ergosterol is exposed to UV light, it produces vitamin D. And it does so in similar amounts to what's typically available in a vitamin D supplement. The next is chitin. And what's really cool, it's a prebiotic fiber. So it has potential to help feed our gut microbiome, but it also helps with the taste and mouthfeel and the texture of mushrooms. And mushrooms are basically the only food source, unless you're going to eat insects, which is kind of where we're going in the future of nutrition for sustainable diets. So it's a huge, unique bioactive in mushrooms that's easily accessible to the whole population. And last but not least is ergothionine. You've probably heard of ergothionine before. It's a sulfur-containing amino acid, which is basically the building blocks of protein. We need protein for hormones, for receptors, for hundreds of reactions in our body. Our body uses protein. But ergothionine isn't classified as an essential amino acid. So, but we can only get it from diets. And the reason why it's not classified as essential is because there's no obvious frank deficiency of ergothionine. But what's cool about it is that we have specific receptors for it in our body. Our body conserves it highly. It doesn't like to let it go. So it gets conserved, meaning that there's likely to be a substantial health effect of ergothionine for our bodies to want to hold on to it and utilize it so much. There's also evidence that in some disease states, probably like mine today, ergothionine is reduced. So it's probably implicated in disease. Now there's new research just published last year showing that every increase in standard deviation, which is a certain level of ergothionine in the blood, was associated with a 20% reduction of dying from heart disease from any cause. Why do we care? Because heart disease is Australia's number one killer. So if potentially mushrooms can provide a great solution to help reduce that risk, but we don't know yet if you actually eat more ergothionine through mushrooms, if it actually increases blood levels, which would be a great research project. So how do those bioactives turn into health effects? So in the 15 studies that we looked at, there were 7 clearly identified health effects. The first is in reducing inflammation. So in markers of inflammation, so the different markers that the study measured, consuming mushrooms reduced inflammation. It also improved cardiometabolic markers, So for example, lowering glucose levels, it helped increase satiety in a study with to do with satiety is a feeling of fullness. So it helped feel fuller for longer. And the most consistent, which is amazing, there is so much evidence that, and they're all pointing the same way, which doesn't often happen in nutrition, is that mushrooms increases vitamin D status. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in detail. There's also evidence that it lowers cancer risk. All this evidence, keep in mind, it's limited, but it's promising. So specific to lowering prostate cancer markers in prostate cancer patients, and also lowering the risk of the population of having ovarian cancer. There's also evidence for improvements in gut health. So not only from reducing odor, like bad breath, to improving the gut microbiome composition and improving symptoms of gut health, like improving constipation, reducing gas, and reducing bloating. And another really relevant health effect that we found is supporting immunity. So improved markers of the immune system that help support a healthy immune system. So how many mushrooms do you really need to eat to reap those health benefits from the evidence? So when you look at the studies, the two that have the most consistent evidence on dose, the first is mushrooms and vitamin D status. So on average, it's about 3 mushrooms can produce 1,000 IUs, which is the recommended daily intake for all population in Australia. So it's not a lot. And most people, at least myself, that love and consume mushrooms, you would get triple that in a serve. So it's really realistic. We're not talking about huge amounts to actually get the health benefit. In the satiety study, it was a bit more, it was just over double that, which again, it's a really realistic recommendation. When someone does consume mushrooms, they are consuming between 3 and 7 at the very minimum. So let's talk about vitamin D. I've actually published in the space of vitamin D and how office workers aren't getting enough. What are the risk factors for getting enough vitamin D in Australia? And the biggest issue is that we are a sunny country, but many people don't get out in the sun. Like if you're an office worker, or if you're in aged care or in hospitals, or if you just have dark skin, and that's a natural blocker of sun. So we're meant to get most of our vitamin D from sun exposure. But the issue is that 1 in 4 Australians are deficient, and we are not getting it from sun. So we have to leverage other ways, which include diet and supplementation. So if you look at the dietary intake of Australians for vitamin D, the recommended depends on age, and it triples for older Australians, so from 5 micrograms to 15. And the average dietary intake in Australia is only 2 to 3. So it's extremely low. And most of it comes from fortified margarine. Now what happens, remember I said that mushrooms actually naturally contain vitamin D. So it contains 2 to 3 micrograms, which is the same amount that the average Australian is consuming. So even potentially if you don't expose mushrooms to sun, it still can contribute to the vitamin D intake in the diet. But what's really exciting is that when you expose mushrooms to the UV light for just about 15 minutes, the same factors that influence how much we produce with our skin would affect how much the mushrooms make, like season, well, how long it's exposed for, and the temperature outside. It will produce 24 micrograms, or can produce, which is 1,000 IUs. And when you compare other dietary sources, it blows them out of the water. So, and you can notice here that most sources that are high are actually animal derived. So with plant-based eating and a movement towards reducing animal foods from a sustainability and a health perspective, it really places mushrooms in a unique position to provide for every single Australian the recommended daily intake with potentially 3 cup mushrooms. It sucks that it's a webinar and I can't see how you guys are reacting, but I hope you're going, yeah. Okay, so moving on, how do you actually maximize your mushrooms 10? It's really exciting, this came out of the research. So if you put the mushrooms with the gills side up, it increases the amount produced by 30%. And if you slice it, because of the increase in surface area, it increases it by 60%. So when we're talking about how much it can actually make, if you use these strategies, it could potentially make even more. We don't actually have the research looking at that specifically, but it's something that can be done. So what's the effect of storage, processing, and cooking? Because I think for Australian mushrooms, there's a real opportunity to leverage the fact that the vitamin D in mushroom is so retainable that you can look for creating mushroom powders, you can look at creating frozen mushrooms or other ways, and the vitamin D will still be retained. But also from a consumer, communicating this with people to improve their health, you can actually put the mushrooms in the sun and then put them in the fridge, and the vitamin D will be retained for up to 8 days, which is basically the shelf life of the mushrooms anyway. So it's a great data that it aligns so beautifully. There's also evidence for canning. It retains in canned mushrooms if you wanted to create canned mushrooms, but also drying. So if mushrooms are dried, it can also become more accessible. It can also be added to the food supply to improve vitamin D and improve nutrition. And 50% of the vitamin D is still retained within 18 months after it's been dried. So it's huge. And the other cool fact is that when you're actually cooking it, you can add a bit of lemon juice to retain even more vitamin D. And it's also recommended to cook at lower temperatures to retain even more vitamin D. So just to showcase how effective increasing vitamin D in the diet from mushrooms can have on plasma levels, because it's great, the evidence is there, it can make vitamin D, but does it actually increase the levels in your blood for your body to use for what it needs? And it can. So this is a great study where I'm just visually showing the control is where they gave people mushroom soup, and this is mushroom soup without being exposed to UV light. It doesn't really make a big difference on their vitamin D levels. Then they gave them supplement and it increased substantially. And then they gave UV exposed mushrooms. And you can see that it followed basically the exact increase as a supplement. So what would you rather? Take a vitamin D pill or eat one portobello mushroom exposed to the sun for 15 minutes? I know what I would prefer. But what's more is that it's a food. And with food comes the whole holistic approach of cooking, the enjoyment, the family meal, in addition to all the other bioactives, the A, B, C, D, E, that I mentioned before, that you're also adding to the diet. Whereas with a pill, it just addresses the deficiency, but it doesn't address anything else lifestyle related. Why is this relevant now? Why am I so excited, even though I have no voice to be excited? It's that vitamin D is proven to help support immunity. So mushrooms are a great source to help get vitamin D. Coming into winter, COVID-19, it's a very relevant message to be communicating. It's also right now, we're about to go into winter, and the main way that people can maintain their vitamin D levels in winter to prevent it from going down, because sun exposure is really not feasible in some latitudes in Australia, like Tasmania. Even if you go out in the sun at midday, you will not make vitamin D in the skin because there's no UV actually hitting Earth. So coming into winter, you really need to leverage food sources of vitamin D to maintain that level. And mushrooms are a great food source along with the eggs and fish and other high sources. And we've never been at home now more than ever before. So you actually have time to go put a load of laundry in if you're working from home. But you also have time to tan your mushrooms. So it's a great opportunity for us to leverage. And on top of that, there's actually a specific recommendation from researchers that ergothionine could potentially be a therapeutic agent for COVID-19. It's a big call they're making, you know, but they are making it. That's how relevant ergothionine is for immunity. And the researchers suggest that having good ergothionine status can help reduce the severity of COVID-19 and potentially reduce mortality. So mushrooms being the largest source of ergothionine in our diet could be positioned in a really nice way to help support this research and recommendation that these authors are making. But again, there's no direct link. This is just the researchers recommending it, so don't get too excited. But it just showcases where mushrooms are going in terms of being a key source of vitamin D that's important for health. and being a key source of ergothionein, two things that are independently associated with improved immunity. So what are some practical mushroom tips? How do you put all this into practice? Like I said, nutrition is only as good if people are actually eating the food. So how can we make people eat mushrooms? What's so special about mushrooms? So mushrooms have the unique umami taste. It's a Japanese word, and it refers to that savory meat factor kind of like taste. And it's one of our basic tastes. So we need to communicate more with people about this. And what's so cool about umami is that it helps sensitize our taste buds. So we don't need to add as much salt. We get the same sensation of salty with 30 to 40% less salt added to the food. It's really incredible. Again, why do we care about salt? Because salt increases hypertension, which is blood pressure, and it's one of the main risk factors of heart disease, which is Australia's number one killer that costs the economy the most amount of money. Umami and mushrooms can also be used as flavor enhancers. On their own, it creates that savory feel and makes food taste better. It has natural glutamates, the same things that people have created MSG from. They're naturally occurring glutamates, which is naturally occurring flavor enhancer. And what's really interesting about combining different umami foods is that the sum of two is greater than the sum of the parts. So if you're combining one umami food with another, for example, Parmesan cheese and mushrooms, the flavor is much greater than the two added together. And that's why, from a cultural perspective, cuisines around the world have leveraged this. In Chinese cuisine, you've got the combination of dried and fresh mushrooms. In Italian cuisine, you've got mushroom risotto. Like, who doesn't love mushroom risotto? It tastes so good because you're combining the truffle oil, the Parmesan cheese, and the mushrooms, creating that umami bomb of flavor. And there's also research that mushrooms can be used as a meat replacer. It's because of their unique proteins, the polysaccharides in mushroom that give that nice mouthfeel. But it's also because of the umami that allows to add more flavor to the food. And there's research showing that, especially in mince dishes, we're using chopped mushrooms to replace some mince. There's a huge improvement in palatability and acceptability by consumers of the food. And a lot of research in the US happening with burgers in school cafeterias. So if kids won't eat it, if it doesn't taste good, kids also taste things differently than we do. So using that concept that it's uniquely positioned because of the glutamates, the umami, the types of protein, and also the chitin in it, that gives it that mouthfeel, savory taste that kind of replaces what you would expect as a consumer when you're consuming meat. So how do you make the most of your mushrooms? Well, first and foremost, remember to put them in the sun, or potentially the industry does it already. For example, for dried mushrooms, I know many are imported and they're sun-dried. So if you analyze dried mushrooms, they are actually quite high in vitamin D because they're doing it already before the consumer gets it. So remembering to put it out in the sun doesn't have to be very long. Put it in the fridge. When you're ready to cook it, make it and get the benefits of the vitamin D. Which mushroom should you choose? Well, from all the Agarcus bisporus, each have their uniqueness. So for example, portobello will produce the most vitamin D, but white button mushroom has more ergothionein, and brown has more ergosterol. So you kind of want a variety. Don't just stick with one, but stick with the one that you like, that you're going to have. And don't waste the mushroom. Don't chop off the stem, because the stem is where most of the glucans are, and the cap is where most of the antioxidants are. So eat it whole. And last but not least, when cooking it, you want to cook at the lower temperatures to retain more vitamin D, but cooking helps enhance antioxidants. So it's okay to cook your mushrooms and eat it raw. And adding a bit of vitamin C from the lemon juice will help retain the vitamin D in the mushrooms, and cook it in extra virgin olive oil to add even more health benefits and bioactives. So what's next for mushrooms? Well, is it a plant or is it an animal? Where does it really fit with our dietary recommendations? Well, we know it's not a vegetable, but it contains resistant starch, phytonutrients, potassium, We know it's not a whole grain, but it has prebiotic fibers and glucans, and it has a riboflavin, which is uniquely found in high amounts in grains. It's not an animal, but it has vitamin D and vitamin B12. And what's so interesting is that mushrooms are technically closer to animals than they are to plants. So why do we regard them as vegetables? And they're even not a nut, but they have selenium and they have copper. And that's because mushrooms are a fungi and they are unique. And nutritionally speaking, they provide a unique proposition in our diet. So when you look at the Australian dietary guidelines and you look at the five food groups, I've put here the key distinguishing nutrients within each food group. So this is the reason why we have to eat a variety of the food groups so we get each of those key nutrients in our diet. Mushrooms have folate. So the amount that I have here for mushrooms are the regulatory RDI. So at least 10% of the recommended regulatory RDI. So it's what's in substantial amounts that can contribute quite a lot to the diet. So it's got folate. So yeah, so technically from the guidelines, it probably fits the most to the vegetable group. But then it has vitamin D, selenium, and biotin. And those are more associated with the animal, the meat, and alternatives group. It also has the glucans, which is more associated with grains. It has niacin, copper, and phosphorus in high amounts, which is not really in any of the food groups. And it has ergosterol, ergothionine, and chitin. So where do they fit? Really, potentially, they should have their own food group. So what are some key things that I want you to remember from my presentation today? That mushrooms are really a nutrition all-rounder. They provide all those nutrients that you need, and they provide them from across the different food groups we consume. They're beautiful on the inside, so they have that prebiotic fiber that could potentially help with immunity, but also with heart health. More research is needed there. It's an unparalleled prebiotic. Not only has the beta-glucans, but it also has a unique prebiotic fiber, the chitin. And that's not found in any of the other food groups either. It's also nature's supplement. It's the easiest way to get your vitamin D while providing other important nutrients and bioactives. It's the first for ergothionine. It's the highest source in our diet. So I really need to watch the research in the space of the health effect of ergothionine and leverage mushrooms in that light. And also don't forget to tan your mushrooms rather than your skin. It's better from a skin cancer risk, and it's as effective as if you were to go outside and get your vitamin D. And I just want to share a video of my daughter. This is from last year. She's now 4, so she was 3 at the time. Just to showcase the holistic lifestyle approach. If we want to get people to eat mushrooms and reap the health benefits or anything in nutrition, we got to involve the younger generations. But also look at it from the link between eating and health to actually make food palatable so people will eat it. So have a look. So that's how I actually sound like, in case you're wondering. So I will never see mushrooms in a different way now. I could just see D's and I see T's, and maybe there's also A's. And I think food is about enjoyment. So we've got to help people eat more mushrooms, but educating them on the health benefits, but also making it taste good so they actually eat it. I'd like to acknowledge Nutrition Research Australia and my team for all the great research and work and translational work that they've done on this project. KSGO Be Kind for the design work, and obviously Australian Mushrooms for funding this important research. Thank you very much. If you'd like to follow us on social, we're here as well. And if you'd like to access the resources that were created for healthcare professionals, they're all on this website, nrls.com/mushroom hub. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Flavia. And I mean, it's so exciting and it's so interesting. And but I feel terrible for you struggling through with this. And so you just yesterday you sounded completely different. So it's really come on. And thank you so much for soldiering on to give that wonderful presentation. Yes. So now actually the sound didn't come through of your little girl
Oh,
at
okay.
the end. So maybe you should explain. She was just making the letters out of the mushrooms.
Oh, yes. It's like, that's right. So she goes, she opens it and goes, do you want me to just try playing again? I guess because it's in here.
I think it's because you've got the earphones
Yeah.
in. Maybe if you just okay.
I'll stick it on and play it again. It's
Okay.
just. Have any questions in No. Let me just disconnect them.
No.
Me 1 second.
No. We're out of luck.
Yeah, there we
No.
go. Okay, can you hear the sound? It's a D for Dino.
Dino. Okay, Dino.
D for Daddy. All mushrooms are your name. Look, T for Talara. There we go. That's my
Oh,
mushroom.
how she takes a big, two big handfuls of mushrooms and just crams them in her mouth. It's just like, it's a classic. Just
Yes.
really, really beautiful. That's what we want is more children doing that.
Definitely.
Yeah. So Jeff says, they're always, so it congratulates you on your presentation. And he says there are always problems in health claims for food. How far can we go along the road with this for mushrooms?
And that's what we're doing at the moment, helping support the project on marketing claims they can make substantiated by science. That's the issue. When you're making health claims to consumers, it has to be substantiated by the science. For vitamin D, we feel like there is enough, so we've recommended to investigate that and create a health claim substantiated for mushrooms and vitamin D. For the rest, you can't communicate it to consumers until the evidence is substantial and it's clear. So as you can see, for most of the research we have, it's 15 studies across all those health effects. So you need more research in humans. So to get a health claim, you need to fund human research showing, for example, that giving mushrooms may help support the immunity. And it would make sense. I'd probably do some sort of study on immunity, upper respiratory infections, because you're going to be getting the prebiotic fiber, you're going to be getting vitamin D and ergothionine if it does have any benefit. And you could do a mushroom intervention on that, but there needs to be more research, unfortunately. There's not enough to communicate with consumers, but there's enough to communicate with healthcare professionals who in turn can communicate however they like for consumers. From a marketing perspective, there's just not enough other than vitamin D in terms of health benefits.
So there have been efforts to market mushrooms already with vitamin D, where they've been exposed to light during the packing process. And I guess they've had some mixed success. But do you think that encouraging consumers to just put, you know, tan their mushrooms might make more of a hook to doing that? And maybe that would help promote that category too, if, you know, of mushrooms that are actually treated to enhance vitamin D might find it easier to market if people can do that.
Yeah, I think my opinion on that, there are two ways to approach it. Either you do it stealthily, and it's just mushrooms have vitamin D because they're exposed to UV. Standard, it becomes a great source across the food supply, or target to consumers. But I mean, it's still an effort. If you're, you know, it's still an effort to put your mushrooms out in the sun, even if it takes 15 minutes, even if it takes 5 minutes. I think that the message is so strong, it's worth communicating with consumers. But at the end of the day, will they actually do it? It'd be nice to do some market research to find out if they would before doing that. But I think from a public health perspective and impact, to just make it as part of the standard that mushrooms are exposed to UV light. Because like communicating that to consumers, they probably think, oh, my mushrooms are being radiated or whatever, like it's being processed. So I'm not sure that messaging would sell as well as if it's just like salt reduction has been done in the food supply. It's stealth, you know, health by stealth. So just do it and no one notices. And then just, it's a way to reduce sodium. And you're not gonna tell people you've reduced it because it's not gonna do as good as the previous version. So it's really, that way, and I think for mushrooms, perhaps that might be a good approach.
So Amanda has asked, do we have to be mindful of where we tan our mushrooms? Is there any soaking up of toxins possible with cut mushrooms in the sun? I guess from a food safety point of view.
Yeah, that's a good question. There is just no evidence to know. So it'd be something that it'd be interesting to analyze and see. Do you mean if you're in a construction site nearby or for airborne contamination? Perhaps, but it would be no different to what you're breathing, standing in the same place the mushroom is.
Yeah.
And the time needed is not very long, so even if there was any risk, it'd probably be very minimal.
Yeah, I would think it would seem unlikely. So David has commented that is the 30% increase in portobellos is the same with white flats.
Yeah, so the more gills exposed, the greater the conversion. Issue is the flats will be the same, so the more gills. But the problem with the other ones, because they're still quite closed, so if you're having button, it's better to slice it to get more. But even if you don't, it still can produce up to 1,000 IUs in 15 minutes. So if you're going to tan it and use it right away, you might as well slice it, because then you can throw it straight in the pan.
Yeah,
if you're because it's remembered and then you're storing it, then there's no need to slice because you'll still get enough vitamin.
Yeah, it's just a matter of surface area, really, isn't it? The amount of surface area is the amount of vitamin D you produce. Michael has asked,
because the gills increase surface, right? Because you're getting all the folds.
Yeah, the gills.
Yeah, because if you do it gills down, then you get less than gills up because of the folds in the surface area.
So Michael has asked, can you compare the level of benefit for agaricus with that for exotic mushrooms?
So
I guess a lot of those studies were looking at exotics as well as agaricus, right?
All this, everything I presented today is agaricus. Everything. Mm-hmm. So we haven't delved into the research on other exotic species, but it's there. You can look into it. I know there's some differences in the amount of herbicide, for example, higher in some mushrooms, but the actual bioactives we haven't reviewed exotic other species. This is purely to meet the need of Australian growers. So it's really predominantly the 95% that's sold in Australia as a key research focus. But there's obviously scope for the 5% as well.
I just thought if you were looking at research papers, because you said how many research papers have looked at mushrooms, but then none had really just looked at agaricus, but presumably some have done agaricus and oyster or something.
Yeah, exactly. And none of them, you know, it was like five or six were systematic out of 300. So the science wasn't really that great. It's a bit wishy-washy. Like, there's a lot, there's interest, but it, like, it wasn't done properly. And in order to get it, substantiate anything, you need a systematic review of the science. Other reviews are still informative. They're great because it gives you an overview. You don't have to always go systematic if you want to get an overview of where the science is at. But to get the health to be sure of what you're finding is you've gotten all the papers, it's systematic.
Okay. Now, Len has asked, how much does cooking decrease the vitamin D in mushrooms? Is it significant, or and what's the difference of adding lemon juice?
I don't have values for that off the top of my head, but I can find out for you. From the paper, what it was. So, but the thing is, I don't want people to get too bogged down with how much you lose of cooking, or because our recommended daily intakes are set to take into account absorption, to take into account cooking, and that's why we have to eat a variety of foods in a variety of ways, and not just take away. So that's why eating only a raw diet is not good, but so is only eating only cooked diet. We need the variety. Antioxidants need cooking to get released. So you're losing more antioxidants in cooking, losing a bit of vitamin D. But at the end of the day, our RDIs are set to take all that into account. So don't worry about that. Yeah. As long as you're eating it, that's all that matters.
And who eats three mushrooms at a time anyway? I'd eat like a whole, if you're going to cook them, you cook a whole bunch. Okay, another question. Do you think it's realistic to try to add mushrooms as their own category on the food pyramid? Do you think the food authorities would be, willing to consider that? Because yes, that would certainly be a great marketing angle.
Of course, yeah. But not only, so not coming from a marketing perspective, but coming from a dietary intake perspective. We held the roundtable as part of the project with key stakeholders last year to answer that exact question. Should mushrooms be their own food group? And the consensus, which we're producing a white paper, which you'll have access to, is that it really, there is a lot of mounting evidence that maybe should be considered or called out at the very least. And it's timely because the Australian dietary guidelines are currently being revised. So if there's any time to actually create change in that space, now is the time. So there, it's not impossible. But it's going to be evidence-based. So that's why we go back to the science and go, okay, how do we create food groups? It's based on key nutrients. But there might be more in the dietary guidelines now. There might be level of processing. There might be sustainability. There might be other, that's why it's being done. So the pyramid is not the government one. That's Nutrition Australia's representation. The government's at play. And another interesting thing is that even oils aren't on the plate. It's just a side thing. So I think there's a huge room for oils and for mushrooms and other foods to be more specifically mentioned in the guidelines.
Yeah, it's exciting times, really. And especially with all the work that's going on with gut health at the moment, and how, you know, the link between your brain and your gut and even mental health and all sorts of issues, which we're now establishing can be solved through improving your gut. So yeah. I think, you know, this is something which is really relevant and exciting. And then if it can solve COVID into the bargain, wouldn't that be amazing?
Exactly.
Well, not solve, but.
Yeah, but that's a thing. So, you know, like some sweeteners, salt. Like, there are things that feed your good bugs, but there are things that also hinder their growth. So mushrooms have quite a few components that feed our good bugs, but it also reduces the need of the other things we don't want, like sodium. So it's a gut-friendly food. It has the unparalleled prebiotic, as we call it.
Yeah. So Tim has commented that, you know, he loves the tagline, "Tan your mushrooms, not your skin." And he says the significance of tanning the mushrooms shouldn't be lost. In the example, like taking 3 micrograms to 24 micrograms, don't tan your skin, tan your mushrooms.
Yeah, it's huge. that's why I'm like, we gotta get this message out, because it's not like, oh yeah, mushrooms can give you some vitamin D. It's like, it blows it out of proportion compared to every other food, but all you gotta do is tan it. So how do we tan it? Do we do it on a commercial scale, or do we try to get people to do it themselves? Vitamin D deficiency, almost 1 in 4 in Australia. I was telling Jenny yesterday, she said, well, why do Australians have one of the lowest dietary vitamin D intakes in the world? And I said, it's because we rely on sun. And all the other countries have huge amounts of vitamin D added to foods. Food fortification for vitamin D is very big because, like in Canada, where I studied, it's in milk. So everyone, all the kids, everyone's getting it from milk. But in Australia, it's not mandatorily added to milk. It is only voluntary fortification, and the amount is quite low. That's why you get it in margarine. There's some breakfast cereals now that have it. Still,
it's amazing.
Compared to 24 micrograms, like the next highest was like 6 or 5.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is amazing. So maybe the answer is, and partly people tanning their mushrooms, and also partly that, you know, the commercial tanning process, as it were, where they're exposing them to intense light during the packing process to help that. Do you think maybe a lot of people are unaware that they're deficient in vitamin D, and that's part of the problem?
The number of diagnoses I've had in the last 15 years, so many, especially if you're, so some of the risk factors, if you're an office worker, if you've got really pale or really dark skin, so really dark, don't make it. They'd have to be in the sun for 3 hours. And really pale, you avoid the sun at all costs. So it's usually, that's a risk factor. Being older, having a chronic disease, and there's a skin cancer risk in Australia that layers on top of that. Mm-hmm. So we want to encourage people to get in the sun. It's still, there's a risk, not everyone can. And even if you are getting your vitamin D in the sun, it's still important to put sunscreen on, because we can't cover every single surface area in our body, so you'll still make it. So if you are in the sun, wear sunscreen, but you'll still make vitamin D. Mm-hmm. But many people are deficient and they don't know. I'd recommend, if you feel like you fit one of those risks, get checked 100%. No, seriously.
Yeah.
People are deficient and they don't know.
Yeah, because that is actually, Amanda has asked, does your body know somehow if you're vitamin D deficient? Can you feel any difference?
Not necessarily. Generally, because it's so important in immune support, maybe if you're getting recurrent infections, it could mean a deficiency, but you know, there's no way of knowing. That's the beauty of nutrition. And that's why it's so hard for people to change. You actually don't see your arteries getting clogged. Right? You don't see getting thin. And it's a lifetime of calcium deficiency, vitamin D deficiency for our brittle bones. And that's why we've got to make this real for people and go like, look, this is how you solve it. This is why it's important. Because nutrition is hard to get people to do it because they don't see it. It's not like a cut. Oh, I broke my arm. Let me go to the doctor.
Yeah.
You know, it takes a long time usually to develop most nutrition-based diseases.
Yeah.
Well, all chronic diseases are underpinned by poor lifestyle.
Yeah.
And one of the key lifestyle factors is nutrition, poor nutrition.
Yeah. So I think are there any more questions that people would like to ask Flavia? We might leave it there, but that was fantastic. I mean, I really think this is so interesting, and it's so topical, and it's really everyone should know this somehow. Should be teaching it in schools or something like that, you know, like it's really good, and it's such an exciting area to be working in. So this webinar has been recorded, of course, and we will send a link to the recording to everyone who's registered. This will the next webinar in the series will be in 3 weeks' time on Thursday, June the 17th, when we will again try to connect with Dr. Lise Corsten at the University of Pretoria, South Africa. Dr. Corsten has extensive experience with mushroom food safety, particularly managing listeria, as well as controlling rots, managing inputs, and improving quality. She's recently been working closely with the South African government agencies on a local outbreak of listeria. Even though mushrooms were not to blame, the industry is coming under increasing pressure for greater government regulation, something I think we can also relate to. So for more on that, Lise will be with us in 3 weeks' time. So this webinar has been brought to you thanks to the Marsh Lawson Mushroom Research Centre Project. And I'd just like to thank Dr. Flavia again for a fabulous presentation. And this has been funded through the Mushroom Levy with funds from the Australian government. And hope to see you in 3 weeks' time. Thank you.